First airing in 2001, Star Trek Enterprise was the fifth and final of the classic live-action Star Trek TV shows. Enterprise had very mixed reviews, and it features its share of horrendous episodes, including some of the worst in the franchise.
I'm not quite sure if congratulations are in order, Commander, but you're pregnant.
But I personally love it, and consider it to be one of my favorite Star Trek series. To me, it takes the fun and premise of the original series, the ethical dilemmas of the Next Generation, the maturity and grit of Deep Space Nine, and the updated CGI effects of Voyager. Be sure to polarize the hull plating, because there will be spoilers. Honorable mentions include United, The Andorian Incident, Silent Enemy, Countdown/Zero Hour, and Cogenitor. Now, without any further ado, here are my top 10 episodes of Star Trek Enterprise. Number 10, Future Tense. The episode opens with Enterprise picking up a tiny spacecraft. It's unlike anything they've ever seen, and further out than they've ever been. Yet the decayed body of the pilot...
He's human.
The crew begins to investigate the mystery of the craft, but soon a Suliban ship attacks, trying to steal it. Enterprise is able to fight them off, but just as Archer and T'Pol begin to realize that the vessel could be from the future, a Tholian ship tries to take it too. Before long, it's a race against time as the crew must unravel the secrets of the vessel as the Suliban and Tholians fight over it. It's an exciting episode that features a tantalizing mystery and an epic reintroduction to the powerful and enigmatic Tholians, which are a personal favorite of mine. Number 9, Dead Stop. Something I admire about Enterprise is how they don't hit the reset button at the end of every episode like other shows. Voyager! So in the previous episode, Minefield, Enterprise suffers serious damage to the saucer from a Romulan mine.
Assuming we can find some tritanium alloy? 3 or 4 months. And with this kind of damage, the best I can give you is... Warp 2.
Archer sends out a distress call, which a Tellarite freighter answers by sending them coordinates to a repair station. Once there, the crew discovers a highly advanced station that's completely automated.
Your inquiry was not recognized.
I don't think there's anyone back there.
The station demands a little compensation and begins to repair the Enterprise with incredible efficiency. Things seem a little too good to be true.
Something doesn't smell right.
Sure enough, soon the situation devolves into a nightmare. This is a great episode that's only become more relevant with the modern rise in self-service and automation.
I need to talk to a person. Someone who can access your database and tell me what happened.
Your inquiry was not recognized.
Who built this station? What species?
Your inquiry was not recognized.
What species?
Any damage to these facilities will be charged to your vessel.
The production value is insane regarding the design of the idyllic-looking station. Fun fact, Roxanne Dawson, who played B'Elanna Torres on Voyager, directed this episode and also voiced the station computer.
Your inquiry was not recognized.
Also, the final shot of the episode is my favorite. Number 8, Ceasefire. This episode sees Archer called in to negotiate a territorial dispute between the Vulcans and the Andorians. Both races have claims to the small world, and fighting has broken out. Fan favorite Commander Shran, played by the legendary chameleon Jeffrey Combs, demands face-to-face negotiation with Vulcan Ambassador Saval. Saval agrees, but things go south when their shuttle is shot down. Unwilling to give up, Archer insists on traversing the war zone to bring Saval to Shran. Meanwhile, Tucker deals with Vulcan arrogance and Andorian aggression in orbit. It's an exciting episode filled with action, intrigue, and quips.
No offense, but my ears are less likely to draw fire than yours.
What is their fixation with our ears?
I believe they're envious.
Number 7, Anomaly. As Enterprise takes her first strides into the expanse, they run into a series of anomalies that cripple half the ship. Not long after, they come across a derelict alien ship, which appears to have been attacked. Archer knows that it's pirates, but before they can do anything, they too are attacked and raided. Tragedy strikes.
I have a dead crewman.
I didn't kill him.
No. One of your friends did. But I don't have one of your friends, I have you.
While searching for the Osarian pirate ship to take back their supplies, Archer discovers a massive artificial sphere. No, the Star Trek one. Yeah, that's it. They discover that the Osarians have been using it as a base, and have been keeping their loot there. They also find something else. This episode is the first time we get a good look at Archer embracing his dark side to get the job done. And it's fun to watch.
The airlock's decompressing, sir. He'll die.
Not for another 20 seconds, he won't.
Also, take a moment to admire this ending shot with me. Number 6. In a Mirror Darkly. This two-part episode is absolutely wild. It starts off with the first contact with the Vulcans scene from Star Trek First Contact, until... well, you'll just have to see. Anyway, the beauty of this two-parter is that unlike any Star Trek episode ever before, the entire story takes place in the Mirror Universe. After an epic Mirror Universe intro, we're introduced to the Terran Imperial flagship Enterprise, where Commander Archer stages a mutiny against Captain Forrest to assume command, and take the ship into Tholian space on a new mission. Their mission: find a captured Earth ship from an alternate universe, and the future. It's soon revealed that the captured ship is the USS Defiant from the Prime Universe. No, not that one. There it is. It's the starship that faded away in the original series episode The Tholian Web. Just like the brilliant original series episode Mirror Mirror, it's a blast watching the cast act as unapologetically evil versions of the characters we know. This is an episode made with love, with original series props and sets faithfully recreated, plus countless other TOS references.
What are you wearing?
I found it in the captain's wardrobe.
Gord. He's a Gord.
Number 5. Impulse. I love this episode. One word. Zombies. As Enterprise travels through the perilous expanse, they pick up a distress call from the Vulcan ship Seleia in a deadly Trellium asteroid field. Archer, T'Pol, Reed, and Corporal Hawkins take a shuttle pod aboard, while Tripp and Mayweather attempt to mine some of the Trellium ore. Aboard the Seleia, the ship is a crippled mess, but that's not the real problem. The Vulcan crew have become deranged and violent. They don't say zombies, but come on, they're zombies. The four of them get trapped aboard, and to make matters worse, T'Pol begins to be affected as well.
Any chance of repairing it? T'Pol.
What?
Once again, I love this episode. The production design of the crippled Seleia and the unsettling score secure this episode as one of the best in the series. Number 4. Azadi Prime and Damage. I know I said the top 10 episodes, but...
I lied. I cheated.
I combined these two, and I'm calling it a two-parter. Because I do what I want. Near the tail end of the Season 3 Zindi arc, Enterprise finally arrives at Azadi Prime, the location of the Zindi weapon. They remain on the edge of the system to avoid detection, but soon the crew realizes there's only one way to destroy the weapon. A suicide mission using a captured insectoid shuttle.
I'm the only one that can pilot that shuttle.
I practiced on those controls. I can get her in.
But I've actually done it.
Captain, you want a senior officer on this, don't you?
I'll be flying the mission.
Both Time Agent Daniels and T'Pol try to dissuade him.
I don't want you to die.
But Archer heeds neither of them. Meanwhile, Enterprise is attacked and crippled in a devastating scene. There are so many awesome subplots in both episodes. The Zindi begin to distrust each other. Archer compromises his morality for the mission. The crew struggles with their losses, and more.
Better their world than ours.
That's what I keep telling myself. But the reality is a good number of the dead will be innocents. And children.
What we do is for them.
Number 3. Twilight. You know what? I think I'll just leave the opening scene right here.
What the hell's going on?
Someone take him back to his quarters.
Weapons are offline!
Captain!
Captain! Yep, that's how it starts. We then catch up with an older archer in a strange place. A very different T'Pol is waiting for him, and she rehearses to him the events of the last 12 years. In the Expanse, Archer was hit with an anomaly that prevents him from forming new long-term memories. T'Pol was appointed captain in his place, and a tactical decision from her left Enterprise unable to stop the Zindi weapon.
Earth.
Destroyed.
It's heartbreaking to watch Archer's devastation over what's become of humanity. To add insult to injury, T'Pol tells him what planet they've settled on.
We're on the fifth planet in the SETI Alpha system.
You lie! In SETI Alpha 5 there was life! A fair chance!
This is SETI Alpha 5!
It's an amazing alternate future episode, with great character moments and space battles, showcasing humanity more desperate than ever before.
There's a small vessel just outside the chromosphere.
Is it Cindy?
Number 2, Similitude. Time for another wild intro. Trip's dead. Cue Faith of the Heart. 2 weeks earlier, Trip is testing a new warp field technique when an accident sends him into a coma and the ship into a polaric field. Dr. Phlox proposes a solution. He has a Lycerian larva that he can infuse with Trip's DNA that will turn the larva into a clone of Trip with a 15-day lifespan. When the clone is the same age as Trip, Phlox will perform a transplant to save Trip's life. T'Pol brings up the moral implications, but Archer disagrees.
Earth needs Enterprise. Enterprise needs Trip.
They begin to run out of time to get Enterprise out of the Polaric field.
In another 4 days, every system on the ship will be offline.
Nucleonic particles build up on the ship's hull as the clone begins to grow. The clone, named Sim, begins to recall memories from Trip's life.
He's starting to look like Trip. And he's beginning to ask questions. Where did I come from? Where is my mother and father? Why am I here?
Directed by legendary LeVar Burton, this is a very heavy episode. Another fantastic Trek study on whether the ends justify the means.
I must complete this mission. And to do that, I need Trip. Trip!
The ending is so powerful and touching that even I get the feels. Number 1. Regeneration. Yes, this is the best episode of Enterprise, and no, I will not apologize for saying so. This episode starts with a literal cold open as an Arctic science team explores the ruins of an ancient crashed ship. They find some bodies, and we, the audience, immediately recognize them as Borg. This episode sports perhaps the most poignant example of dramatic irony as the crew digs up Borg corpses, having no idea the danger they're in. Wouldn't you know it, things go very wrong. The Borg hijack the Arctic transport, and Enterprise is ordered to track them down and save the research team. Enterprise is soon in over their heads, facing Borg both within and without the ship. This is an incredible episode that fixes what many say Voyager broke. The Borg are made scary again. The action and production design are brilliant, as is the haunting score. One of the things that impresses me most about this story is how they fit it neatly into the timeline without breaking canon, allowing the events of the episode to be caused by Star Trek First Contact, and the events of this episode even potentially triggering the events of TNG's episode Q-Who. A legendary feat of writing.
They told their homeworld how to find Earth.
Did you learn where the message was sent?
Somewhere deep in the Delta Quadrant.
Then I doubt there's any immediate danger. It would take at least 200 years for a subspace message to reach the Delta Quadrant, assuming it's received at all.
Sounds to me like we've only postponed the invasion until what? The 24th century?
So there you have it. My top 10 episodes of Star Trek Enterprise. So what do you think? Did I nail it? Or do I need to sort myself out with some Vulcan neural pressure? Let me know in the comments below. If you have your own top 10 list, please share it there too. Until next time, Nuclear Films, out.